Hi, my name is Jason Ferguson, and I'm here today to do a recorded education session with my student here, Tommy. Today's session is going to involve patient education primarily. Patient education is important for any healthcare professional to have down because it's positively linked to patient adherence, satisfaction, and understanding. Now, this session will involve a brief teaching component where I go over some tips for patient education, as well as a brief teaching component on our topic at hand today, which is going to be diabetes type 2, and in particular, monitoring a HbA1c test and why it's important to monitor, which is a common occurrence with patients, is why do they need to get all these tests done. So today's learning outcomes are going to include teaching and student demonstration of non-verbal communication skills, teaching and student demonstration of verbal communication skills, teaching a brief overview of diabetes monitoring in the context of patient education, and teaching patient education framework, ask, tell, ask, and student demonstrating a proficiency in the ask, tell, ask framework. Now, the ask, tell, ask framework is, as it implies by the name, is simply broken up into three different stages of patient education. So, ask what they want to know, tell them what they want to know, and then ask them again if they understand what you've said. So ask permission to start the conversation, to get involved, the ball rolling. Ask the patient to describe their understanding of either the healthcare visit, the disease, or the treatment. So in this situation, if we're focusing on diabetes treatment, we'll be like, what do you understand about your monitoring? Do you know why we're doing this blood test and why it's important? This method helps you tailor, so like you're not just giving them a bunch of information that they may already know or a bunch of information that they're not ready for yet. So you tailor your education to what they want to know and what they ask about. The tell part, so you're providing information, short sentences free of medical jargon and terminology. And ask again. Ideally, you want the patient to clarify, to reiterate their understanding in their own words of what you've told them. If they're not comfortable doing that, or if they don't want to do that, just use open questions to clarify their understanding if they want to go over a few things again, or if they have other issues or concerns about it that they want to talk about. So it's a pretty straightforward framework, ask, tell, ask, and it's quite commonly used in patient education. Now, in patient education, it's important for good communication skills. So in light of that, I'm going to briefly go over a few things today. More refreshers, as my student here, Tommy, is a senior medical student, and he would have, at the stage in your student career, gone over a lot of these things before. But it's important that we go over it a bit so you know it's fresh in your mind, and then we can start a simulation, and you can show me how well you do at verbal and non-verbal communication skills. So a few tips, non-verbal communication, setting the environment up. So if you're doing patient education, you don't want it on a busy ward round. You don't want it in a very loud area where there's a lot of distractions. So you want privacy, quiet location, comfort is important, especially if the patient's in an emotional state, if they've just been diagnosed with something, and you're trying to educate them on what they've been diagnosed with, they might not be ready to receive the information yet. So you might make another appointment for them to come in and when they sort of come to grips with their diagnosis. So in terms of situations, so like the distance between you and the patient, it's important. Facing the patient, so like here, if you're the patient, I don't want to be sort of looking at my nose typing and sort of looking over my shoulder at you. That's not really respectful and it doesn't engage the patient. In terms of body language, you want to be open and relaxed, facing the patient, ideally. You don't want to be too close, make them uncomfortable. But you sort of don't want to be too far away behind a desk because they might not hear you. Engaging active listening. So making eye contact, making affirmative sounds, nodding your head, ensuring they know that you're listening and so encouraging them to contribute and keep going with their conversation. In terms of verbal communication skills, again, avoid the use of jargon. So it's hard through a long medical career to remember that some of the words that you think are just normal and like everyday usage may not actually be simple terminology. adopt a clear voice, so don't try and hurry through the patient education, so maintain pace and tone. And again, use short sentences to explain things, don't do long-winded explanations. Mm-hmm. Now, why my student today, Tommy, is well-versed in type 2 diabetes, I'm sure, which is important actually, because it's a good measure of your understanding if you can explain it in simple terms. So knowing the pathophysiology in detail enables the practitioner to explain it in simple terms because they know how to get down to the fundamentals of it. So besides that you do know, I'm going to go over a few common sort of statements that come up in terms of diabetes education. So just so give you like a brief framework on like easy common answers to these questions. So one of the most common things that can come up in patient education is a patient says, I'm not getting any symptoms of diabetes, why should I care about it? And this is important for you to sort of nail in the head there because you want them to understand the gravity of the situation. So a possible way to answer that is, even though you might not be feeling it now, the long-term effects of diabetes can have serious complications or serious impacts on most of your organ systems. So we want to get on top of it now so that you don't have the serious side effects later on in your life when it's too late to do anything about it. So, at this point, you could also include what it leads to, so like increases risk for heart disease, increases risk for kidney disease, increases risk for eye damage, or eye vision loss rather, and loss of feeling or pain in fingers and toes. Mm. Amputation is a big fear of a lot of patients, so it's a good example to give to make sure that they understand that it's an option if they don't get on top of things. Mm. Okay, one of the other questions, which is important, HbA1c, why am I taking it? What does it mean? A lot of clinicians can fall into the trap of just saying, oh, your HbA1c level is 8, that's not good. Whereas they don't explain why it's not good, what it means. Like some of the other tests you do, they're pretty self-explanatory, like your blood sugar level was this, so they, you know, a patient understands that. But an acronym like HbA1c, unless you look into it, this doesn't really explain what it is. So a possible way to describe the test and why it's important, HbA1c, hemoglobin A1c, is a product we measure in your blood to see how well you're monitoring your glucose over 2 to 3 months. This is important because the finger prick glucose you do that you might be doing as part of your diabetes regime only gives you a snapshot at that particular time of your blood sugar level. Whereas this test gives us a longer view of how well you're managing your treatment or how well the treatment's working and if we need to tailor or change your treatment. Again, at this stage, you could be say this is included why it's important, as in the complications or the possibilities of damage to your kidneys and eyes, etc., if we don't manage it now. So that's just a way of putting emphasis on why it's important to do this test and why it's important for them to keep on top of their treatment plan, whichever it may be. And again, for treatment monitoring, we tend to HbA1c below 7% is ideal. Which I'm sure you know, but it's also important that if it's higher, you don't scare the patient, as in like you don't sort of scold them. Mm. So it's a good way to say like this is what we want ideally, but if they understand the ramifications or complications, we can work with them to bring it down. Okay, now we're going to do a simulation teaching. So now that we've gone over a few tips and hints about patient education, I'm going to act as a patient for my student here, Tommy, to educate me about what we've been talking about, diabetes, HbA1c, and the importance of monitoring and the complications of not controlling your diabetes. Now in this scenario, I'm going to be a patient that's been recently diagnosed with type 2 diabetes. I've come in for a routine checkup and my HbA1c level is elevated. Let's give it a figure of 10%. Okay? Mm-hmm. Now you are, you can be a doctor in this one, the GP.
Yep.
And what you're trying to do is you're trying to educate me about why it's important to have HbA1c and what it means and why it's important for me to be involved and get my blood sugar lower.
Okay. Yep. That's nice. So we
can use like the non-verbal and verbal communication skills we talked about. So we can't do much about the environment now, but how we're sitting right now is pretty good.
Yep.
And then we'll go from there. And after we do the simulation, I'll give you some feedback.
Yep.
And see how we go.
Okay.
All right.
No worries. Sounds good. So I'm assuming that I'm the GP. You've come in as my patient.
Yep. Come in. I'm sitting down. Awesome. And I'm ready to be talked to.
Okay. So Jason is my patient. So as you say, I've got your HbA1c results, Jason. And I'm just having a look at them now. I've noticed that they're a little bit high. So they're at 10%. This probably doesn't mean much to you. Do you know much about HbA1c, what these figures mean? Do you know anything at all about HbA1c?
No, it's not related to diabetes. I don't really know what it means.
Yeah, yeah. So do you mind if I tell you a little bit about HbA1c?
No, please do.
Okay. So given that you have diabetes, you know, HbA1c is one of the tests that we do to basically look at more of a long-term picture of your blood sugar levels over about 2 to 3 months.
Yeah.
So the HbA1c is that blood test that we do to see how, you know, the level of control of your blood sugar levels have been, as I say, over the past 2 to 3 months. Ideally, we want to be below 7, especially for diabetics as yourself. But as you can see here on the test results, it says it's at 10%. So that's obviously above 7.
Yeah.
It's a little bit on the high side.
Okay.
Do you know much about what the implications are of that?
No, because I feel fine. Like, it doesn't really matter if it's...
Yeah, so we do worry about your HbA1c levels because when your blood sugar levels is high, it can have long-term implications and long-term consequences, you know, on your health. And that's what we worry about. And even though you say that at the moment you feel fine, the thing is, diabetes, it's considered a chronic condition. So it's something that you tend to live with for many years. Majority of people live with diabetes for the majority of their life. And if they don't control their blood sugar levels, then they can get complications. So it can affect things like your cardiovascular system, so you might get heart problems. It can affect your kidneys as well. So, you know, that will obviously affect, you know, your urinary system. It can affect your eyes as well. So in the future, you might get some like blurring of the vision, that sort of thing. It can also affect your sensation through your body, particularly like in your hands or your feet. So you might get some numbness or tingling. And diabetes itself, because it's sugar, you know, things like bacteria, they thrive off sugar, so it can predispose you to infections and things like that. So what I'm trying to say is that diabetes, it's a chronic condition, and so if your blood sugar levels remain high and they're not controlled, or we don't bring them back down to a, you know, a normal or a controllable level, later down the track, in a few years' time, you'll start to experience these complications.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, so it's just to make sure that I don't get that, the bad stuff later on.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Just to reiterate, although you feel well now, if we don't control your blood sugar levels and, you know, get the ball rolling, do some preventive measures, you'll definitely experience complications in the future.
Okay.
So that's why we want to control that. So I guess, you know, given that we have a limited time in the GP session, I won't go into detail as such as to how to control your HbA1c levels and how to control your blood sugar levels, but I can book you for a future session on the diabetic educator. They can go into detail teach you about lifestyle measures.
Yeah.
But have you heard of any ways how to control your blood sugar levels at all, or what do you tend to do?
Yeah, when the doctor first diagnosed me, he told me I need to eat better and exercise, so...
Yeah, yeah.
I just haven't really got around to that yet. So.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, yeah, that's exactly what we want you to do. It sounds like some vague statements. As I said, in a future session, we'll go into that into more detail. But before I finish this session, I just want to quickly say, just make sure you're on top of your medications.
Yeah.
That's really important.
Yeah,
eating healthy, so just quickly, what we mean by that is just avoid junk food, avoid simple sugars, just try and keep a nice balanced diet, and exercise as well as you can. So those are probably the key things. But we will go into that in a little bit detail in our next session, as I said. Do you have any other questions about HbA1c or anything else that you want to clarify?
No, it's good to know that, like, why I'm getting it done. I just felt fine. I didn't realize, you know, it's not really a big deal, but I think I don't really want to have all those problems in my body, so it's good.
Exactly. You know, as I said, even though you feel well now, later down the track, you know, complications can arise. And some of the worse of complications, I guess, things like, you know, because you can get predisposed to infections and you tend to lose your feelings in your feet and that sort of thing, you can get things like diabetic foot ulcers and long, like at the end scale of treatment, you know, if it's really poorly controlled, we might even have to resort to things like amputations and stuff, which is quite nasty. You
Yeah, I
don't
don't
want to
want
get to
that.
that
No.
stage, you know. So we want to prevent that. So let's book you in the next session. We'll talk about how to control your HbA1c levels in more detail. Does that sound good?
Yeah, thank you, Doc.
Okay, no worries. Well, thanks for today, Jason, and I guess we'll see you in the next session.
Cheers. Okay, thank you, Tommy, for that simulation, that scenario. That was really good. I'm just going to give you some feedback now, if that's all right with you.
That's fine.
Okay, let's start with what you think you did well.
Well, just given the theme of the scenario, you know, diabetes, the HbA1c, I was quite comfortable talking about that because, you know, as a med student, I have to learn these things. So I think one of the things that I was quite comfortable with in that scenario was just simply talking about those topics because, you know, I had a good background knowledge. So I think that's what I did quite well in. Just,
I think you're really, sorry, keep going.
and I was just going to say, yeah, I just felt comfortable like explaining those concepts
Yeah.
and explaining it to the patient.
Okay, good. I agree. I think you did really well with that. I also think you did really well with how you communicated. So you had a good tone of voice, you weren't hurried, you made good body posture, good eye contact, you weren't just, you didn't have any notes to look at, but you weren't sort of looking around or like, some people, when they're trying to think, they look up and away. You kept your focus on me as a patient, which I think is really good. Only thing I can think of, because you did really well, that could be improved on is, like you said, you had good, you've got a really good subject matter knowledge, but because of that, sometimes there's a bit of jargon that can come into it a little bit. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, I guess that was probably the main thing that I could have improved on. I mean, there were times where I was just trying to think in my head, how can I swap this word for a more layman's term? But yeah, there were instances where I kind of fell in the trap of saying a few technical words here and there. And I guess that's something that I can just improve on in time.
And I think it's good because you didn't, it wasn't a very noticeable, like you didn't use many of them. For the most part, like you, I especially liked how you talked about attacks on your heart. Like you didn't say like heart disease, you said, you know, like it can lead to heart attacks or it can lead to pain in your heart. You gave them actual symptoms to think about, like actual physical symptoms that diabetes can lead to, which I think is a really good explanation of it. And in terms of how you can get better at it, I think it would just really come down to through your career. You're going to be doing this a lot, obviously, vision education. And you can either do some bit more research to have some sort of like a thesaurus in your head for like, this is what I learned about, but this is an easy way to explain it to patients. And again, just practice makes perfect, really. The more times you do it, the more comfortable you'll be using the layman explanations of these diseases and treatments.
I absolutely agree. I think I just need to get a little bit more practice in, and then
Yeah.
things will come a little bit more smoothly.
All right. Just to tie together or summarize our learning here today, the learning outcomes we had that I think we've covered. So I've taught you demonstration of nonverbal communication skills, and I've seen you perform them on me, which I thought was really good. Student demonstration of verbal skills, so which we've talked about as well, like the jargon-free language and simple structured language structure. We did a very brief overview of diabetes monitoring and HbA1c. Wasn't the focus of today's session, but we did cover a few of the bigger common questions, and you've obviously you got the background behind it, so that was good. I teaching the patient education framework, ask, tell, ask, and the final learning outcome, you demonstrated a proficiency in the ask, tell, ask framework on me as a patient in the clinical scenario, which ties together all the learning outcomes I had for this teaching session. I'd like to thank you for your time today, and I hope you learned something from it.
Yeah, I certainly did. Thanks for having me, Jason.
Cheers.